the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
We have seen lots of important and interesting developments today vis-a-vis the Election Commission and then also involving the Supreme Court of India, etc., but essentially about the Election Commission. So I will try to declutter that for you. And the second thing, inevitably, I will talk about cricket and about the team that's been selected and some features of the team. And also, since we are a country of 1.35 billion cricket coaches, my view on the team. But first, the Election Commission. So the Election Commission in this season, in this really bad season of campaigning, bad as in it's abusive, it's bitter, it's vicious, it's never a breeze in India, but this time it's been particularly bad. It took its first precipitate steps and first clear punitive steps when it banned Yogi Adityanath from campaigning for 72 hours. It's a lot in the election season when the next round of polling is going to take place very soon. And also Mayawati, who also has big stakes in the same state of Uttar Pradesh, for 48 hours. Both had made statements that the Election Commission of India found unacceptable. Yogi Adityanath had talked about the army, he had talked about being Modi ki Sena, he had talked about some other issues on communal lines. Mayawati, on the other hand, had basically made a communal appeal to the Muslims to vote for her party or Mahagathbandhan, SP plus BSP. So, Election Commission acted against both of them and has imposed these bans. Such a strong action has been taken by the Election Commission after a very long time. So, this is a case of, you know, I remember that line from that Lakshmi Bai, Subhadra Kumari Chauhan's famous ballad on Lakshmi Bai, Bude Bharat mein bhi aayi, phir se nahi jawani thi. To ye kuch aise lagta hai ke, Bude Election Commission mein bhi phir se nahi jawani hai. That means the old Election Commission also now is flexing its muscles. It is a very good thing. It's a very welcome thing because Election Commission of India is a very important institution. If we have to believe in our democracy, then we have to believe in the Election Commission and its capability and its integrity and its spine to deliver a fair election to us, because that election then decides who rules us centrally or in the state assemblies or then onwards right down to the panchayat level. So, election process is critical to the functioning of a democracy. If the election process loses credibility, then people lose trust in democracy. So, it's a good thing that Election Commission is now acting. First, it acted by blocking that Modi biopic and then saying that no biopics can be released during the election season. And now they have done this and they have taken some more steps and also issued some more warnings, etc. Now, this is a good thing, but there's another complication that's come up today. Because the EC stopped the Modi biopic, those who wanted it released went to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court has given an order to the Election Commission of India, which, I mean, I'd prefer not to use an expression like bizarre, but it is bizarre because, you know, any replacement or any substitute I find for bizarre in this case will be stronger than bizarre. So, first of all, the Supreme Court has said, you watch the film. Now, it's a Modi biopic. Does the Supreme Court then expect the Election Commission members to watch the film and then make up their minds? You know, first of all, it's a punishment. It may be a punishment. I'm not judging somebody's film. Maybe it's a fantastic film. But then let them pay their money and watch the film in a cinema hall if they feel like. Supreme Court ordering the three election commissioners to watch a three-hour film. It is bizarre. And second, that after watching this, they should write a review of the film. My words, and I am being facetious, but to write their views on the film and submit them to Supreme Court of India in a sealed envelope. I mean, what's going on? This Supreme Court loves sealed envelopes. I think in another year or so, the Supreme Court is going to have an archive of sealed envelopes. This is the wrong way to enforce the rule of law and constitution in India, because this Supreme Court also got Rafale papers from this central government in a sealed envelope. They've just got another sealed envelope situation, and now they're creating one more. And remember, even BCCI, what compensation will the members of the committee of administrators will be paid for their work for BCCI is lying in a sealed envelope, and how long? For almost 3 years now. So Supreme Court of India, which teaches us all transparency, is doing its own stuff, in fact giving its own orders in sealed covers, or getting the evidence that his orders are being followed in sealed covers. Otherwise, what sense do you make of its orders on electoral bonds, that the details of which party got how much in electoral bonds from which donor will be given to Election Commission of India in sealed covers? The whole idea of a transparent democracy is people should know. And when governments or the executive or even the corporates, anybody hides from people what people need to know, they go to the court and finally to the Supreme Court to make sure that these things are made public. In this case, the court itself, in this case, once again, this specific case, think. The Supreme Court of India has ordered the Election Commission of India to watch a film and to write a report to them and submit it in a sealed cover. I mean, once again, I am being facetious, but I have to speak my mind. Once again, this will be the first instance of the Supreme Court of a democracy asking three constitutional functionaries, that is, election commissioners, to watch a film, write a review, and submit it to them for their scrutiny in sealed cover. I'm so sorry, but you know, I cannot see the sense of this. So, while you've heard me complain about this doctrine of sealed covers and also declutter for you the Election Commission actions today, one thing that's no longer in a sealed cover and it's out before all of us is this. This is the list of 15 players to go and represent India in the World Cup beginning very soon now, this summer. Now, many pundits would have already spoken about this and will continue to speak about this. Let me say a few things, however. One, there isn't really a big surprise in this team selection. Most people in this team select themselves. The weaknesses that you see in the team are weaknesses which have persisted in Indian cricket for some time now, which is middle order batting. So middle order batting, that is 4-5-6, or 5-6-7, like that, they've been a struggle in the test cricket. In test cricket, because Kohli bats number 4, you think number 4 is okay, and Pujara bats number 3. But again, 5-6, there is always uncertainty. In ODIs lately, India has had very strong reliance on the top 3. So top 3 are good. Shikhar Dhawan, Rohit Sharma select themselves. KL Rahul, as a standby opener, selects himself. Kohli as number 3 selects himself. That's okay. Then you come to 4-5-6, and that's where you run into some trouble. There are many claimants there. There is the new person, Vijay Shankar, who may be a little bit of a surprise. He is, I mean, it will be unfair to call him a bits and pieces cricketer, but he is a batsman who can bowl a bit. He's very new. He had a decent tour of New Zealand. So he, to me, is a little bit of a surprise in this squad, and selectors have been bold in picking him. Mind you, he's not very young either. He's 28, so he's been playing for some time, and I'll come to the age issue in just a couple of minutes. And then you see heavy reliance here on spinners. So there is Kedar Jadhav, who can do both, who can bat, but who can also spin. And he has that peculiar way of bowling, which makes it very difficult for the batsman to score. Plus, he has the ability to get through his overs very quickly. So, he is somebody who can apply the brakes in the middle, and he can also hit the ball. And when he hits it, it stays hit. So, there is Kedar Jadhav, Kuldeep Yadav and Ravindra Jadeja. So there are three spinners Yajuvendra Chahal, four spinners. So chances are that you will have two mainline fast bowlers. The team has three of them. That is Mohammad Shami, Jasprit Bumrah and Bhuvneshwar Kumar. Depending on what the conditions are, two of the three will play. If it's a swinging conditions, then obviously Bhuvneshwar will play. If it's not swinging conditions, as is expected this summer in England, then maybe Shami and Bumrah will play and Bhuvneshwar will be the standby. And then Hardik Pandya, who's there, everybody's favorite, or everybody's not such a favorite. Don't ask Diana Edelji, I said so. So he will be the third seamer who can bat a bit, particularly in crunch moments. And then you have some usual suspects. You have Ravindra Jadeja, who can bat a bit at number 7, number 8, but he's a finger spinner. So if pitches are not so dry, if it starts to rain, if pitches get wet, then he will come handy because he's sharp and he's accurate. And then you have some batsmen. There's KL Rahul, as I said. He's there in reserve. And there isn't much more in reserve by way of batting. But the fact is you can only take 15. That's the reason that I regret the fact that someone like Pant, Rishabh Pant, has not made it to this team. In fact, if I might have any complaint, it will be Rishabh Pant. But in whose place would he have made it? If he was to fit into this 15, then Dinesh Karthik would have to be replaced by Rishabh Pant. So as the selectors explained, their logic was that Dinesh Karthik, that second keeper, will only play if Dhoni is not well. Now, if Dhoni is not well or is, God forbid, injured, then you need an experienced keeper and an experienced batsman. Rishabh Pant is very talented, he's very attacking, he's a free spirit, but maybe you do not need a free spirit right now. So selectors have been cautious in picking Dinesh Karthik, particularly if, think of a situation that India makes a semi-final, and as India should, and goes ahead, and in one of those matches Dhoni has a problem. Do you really want to go with a raw wicketkeeper, relatively raw wicketkeeper, and a free-spirited batsman in such a high-tension game? So Dinesh Karthik is somebody who has finished many crunch games, who's been around a long time. Remember, this is something that I wasn't conscious of, but my colleague Shreyas Sharma just reminded me of that. Dinesh Karthik is the senior-most member in this team, in the sense that he made his debut even before MS Dhoni. So he's been around a long time and he's been in and out, and who knows, this may just be his World Cup. So yes, I would have preferred to see Rishabh Pant, I would have preferred to see Prithvi Shaw, but then there is only 15. If it's 15, then give or take Rishabh Pant in place of Dinesh Karthik, this is a decent team. Now, one thing about this team, this is one of the older teams that we are sending to the World Cup. Average age of this team is 30. Of the 15, 7 players are above 30. It's unusual today. Of these, the oldest is, of course, Dhoni, who will turn 38 on 7th of July while the World Cup is on. But then he is also the fittest 38-year-old you've ever met. So his fitness is not a problem, his commitment is not a problem, and his cricketing mind is not a problem. But remember, he'll be 38. There are others. There is Kedar Jadhav, who's 34. Dinesh Karthik, who's 34. There is Ravindra Jadeja at 30. Rohit Sharma at 31. Virat Kohli at 30. Shikhar Dhawan at 33. And even if you look at the rest, there are two at 29. That is Mohammad Shami and Bhuvneshwar Kumar. And then there are Yajuvendra Chahal, Vijay Shankar, both of them at 28. And then KL Rahul at 26. Couple of 25-year-olds then. Jasprit Bumrah and Hardik Pandya, looks like they've been around for a long time. And then Kuldeep Yadav at 24 is the baby of the team. So this is a team about which you can say that one thing it does not lack is experience and averages. So everybody in this team has a track record. These are proven people. Selectors have not taken any chances. They have not experimented, except maybe with Vijay Shankar. And while we would have liked to see some of the new young guns in the team, the fact is, in an away World Cup, maybe experimenting is not such a good idea. Now, what you have to hope for is that this team performs, that everybody stays fit. Of course, till May 23rd, remember, with ICC's permission, changes can be made in this lineup. But overall, this looks like a fair selection. So let's all, because we are all partisans when it comes to cricket, and at least on cricket, we are all voting for one party and one symbol, and we don't need any election commission or the third umpire. So let's hope for the best, and let's send our best wishes to this squad. This squad at average age 30 doesn't matter. It's a very fit squad. Indian cricketers are now very fit. They are as fit as cricketers anywhere in the world. And they are tested and tested and tested all the time. This squad has it in it to deliver in this World Cup, particularly because, as you read weather reports, advanced weather reports, it looks like it's going to be a very dry summer in England this year. Dry summers mean flatter wickets, wickets that might take a little spin, and also dry summers mean conditions which will not swing as much as it usually does in England. So the chances of being 6 for 2, I'm not saying it will never happen, it can never happen. With India it can always happen, or with anybody can always happen. But generally the chances of something like that happening, an early collapse because of swinging conditions, is unlikely in this season. So there are many things going for India. A little bit of luck and this team will go places.